Have a lot to get through this morning. We want to begin with that absolutely devastating accident in Baltimore in the US.
This is the dramatic video of the moment. A fully laden cargo ship ploughed into a bridge pylon, bringing down the 2.5 kilometre structure. This is a live look right now at what is left of the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Daylight has revealed the full extent of this tragedy. Now, it happened at 1:30 a.m. local time. 8 construction workers fell 56 metres into that river below. 2 people were rescued, but 6 are still missing. A Mayday call gave workers time to stop traffic just moments before the ship crashed. That quick response saved lives. President Biden has spoken about the collapse and promised to rebuild the bridge. Live to reporter Kate Fisher, who is there at the scene. Kate, this is a horrifying situation. What more can you tell us?
Absolutely. We are still looking for 6 people who were working on that bridge when this enormous cargo ship crashed into it. It is 984 feet long, and experts say the impact of that on the bridge structure meant that there was no any alternative, that bridge just collapsed. And if you look at that video, you see it crumpling like a house of cards within seconds. Terrifying to see. And 8 people were on it working, fixing potholes. They were a construction crew working through the night. They plunged into that very cold water in the dark. 2 of them got out. 1 was okay. The other went to hospital and is now out of hospital. But search and rescue teams are still looking for those remaining 6 workers. Helicopters have been circling overhead all day. They're looking from the air. They're also looking, of course, in the water using sonar equipment. They say they have found some vehicles underneath that bridge. And also police rescue boats have been moving from the harbour where I'm standing here throughout the day, just trying to see if they can find these missing people. President Biden, as you say, has just delivered an address from the White House in the last couple of hours, and he ruled out any terrorism involved in this event.
Everything so far indicates that this was a terrible accident. Personnel on board the ship were able to alert the Maryland Department of Transportation that they had lost control of their vessel, as you all know and reported. As a result, local authorities were able to close the bridge to traffic before the bridge was struck, which undoubtedly saved lives.
Now, the president has made it clear that the priority right now is this search and rescue operation. But he did say that the federal government would fund the rebuilding of this bridge, which is likely to take years at the moment, leaving the people of Baltimore with some real traffic problems, as well as the port of Baltimore, one of the busiest on the US's East Coast. It's going to take a long time for that to get back up and running as it was once before. President Biden saying 15,000 jobs rely on the port functioning. So initial operation for search and rescue, but going forward, there are so many more questions. Why did this happen? How did this happen? And how will they stop it from happening again?
Yeah, as you say, this is the critical link between Washington, D.C. and New York City. For Australians waking up this morning, we can't get over this vision, this footage, as the world is watching this. Kate, can you just take us back to this footage we're seeing now and the question about how on earth it happened? There's some speculation that that ship lost power.
Yeah, that's right. We certainly eyewitnesses have said that there seemed to be some kind of smoke coming from the ship, and then the lights went out just a few seconds before this happened, and the ship seemed to move course. We're told that harbour masters are always on these huge ships as they navigate the way out of the port. They are people who live and work here at the port of Baltimore. They know these waters like the back of their hand, and they are on every single one of these huge cargo ships to make sure that they steer the correct way through these waters. But even with that person on board, this happened, which leads certainly initial speculation to suggest that there was some kind of fault on this ship, which meant that it veered off course. And as you mentioned in your introduction, the crew on board realised this has happened, and they let out that Mayday alert before the impact on the bridge. And that allowed officials on the ground to stop traffic from going on to the bridge, which may well have saved many, many lives. Because even though this was during the middle of the night, this bridge is still a very busy one, even in the night. And the governor of Maryland saying that he believes the people who made that alert were heroes and definitely meant that the loss of life was less.
Yeah, absolutely. We are also standing by for a news conference from the Maryland Transportation Authority. We'll bring you that as they speak. We've just got that up on our screen. Can you just let us know, could you confirm there were vehicles that went into that water?
Yeah, that's right. We're told by the Fire and Rescue Service that there were vehicles submerged in the water. They don't yet know, or they certainly haven't told us, whether there was anybody in them, whether they were empty or not, and whether they were all associated with this construction crew who were working, or whether there was anybody else involved. Certainly, the official line at the moment is that they're only looking at 8 people who were on the bridge at the time. And as I say, 2 are accounted for. It's those other 6 that they are looking for now. And of course, the huge concern is that this water is very cold. And it was, you know, over 12 hours ago now that this happened. So there is a lot of concern here about the situation and the condition of those people who are still missing.
Yeah, on our estimate, it looks like it's about 12 degrees Celsius in Baltimore right now. I'm sure that water would be colder as we look at the daytime shots. So it sounds like the Mayday call allowed people to get people off the bridge somehow. How many minutes before do we think that Mayday call went out? And how in reality did that work with getting people off the bridge?
Yeah, we haven't been told exactly what that length of time was, but essentially the crew on board realised there was a problem and made that call to the Coast Guard, who then alerted officials on either side.
Kate, and we'll go to the Maryland Transportation Authority.
Your questions.
Thank you for joining us. My name is Jennifer Homendy, and I'm the chair of the National Transportation Safety Board. Normally, our investigator in charge, his name is Marcel Muise, M-U-I-S-E. His first name is M-A-R-C-E-L. Marcel Muise is our investigator in charge for this investigation. But just given that we've arrived on scene today, it's very early. I've asked that he remain at the command post to continue what he is doing so that I can brief you on what we're doing so far. Also with me is one of our newest board members. This is Alvin Brown, and this is his training launch. So the NTSB arrived on scene at 6 a.m. To investigate an accident involving a Singapore-registered vessel with the name Dali, D-A-L-I, which made contact with the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore, Maryland, at around 1:30 a.m. this morning. The vessel is 985 feet long. It's a 95,000 gross ton container ship. I've seen information about crew members on board. We still need to verify the numbers of crew on board and their status. Under our memorandum of understanding with the Coast Guard, the NTSB is leading this investigation. The Coast Guard will support this investigation. Our memorandum of understanding, for example, provides for when an accident involves another mode of transportation and other factors, the NTSB will lead that investigation. Now, I want to thank the U.S. Coast Guard. We have a very cooperative relationship with the U.S. Coast Guard. I particularly want to thank Deputy Commandant for Operations, Vice Admiral Gauthier. I want to thank Admiral Gilbreth, who's commander of the 5th Coast Guard District, and Captain O'Connell, who's the sector commander. Before I go on behalf of the NTSB, I want to extend our deepest sympathies to those who have been affected by this significant event. The NTSB, as I mentioned, does many significant transportation events, not just aviation. We do accidents and incidents in marine safety as well, and of course with bridges and other highway infrastructure. And for this, there were many that were affected by this collapse, and our deepest sympathies go out to the families, loved ones, and others who have been affected. I'm going to get questions on fatalities and injuries, which I'm not going to answer. That is not something that the NTSB answers. I will refer you to local authorities on all of that information. What I can tell you is a search and rescue is still underway. So we are very hopeful, and again, our thoughts are with the families and their loved ones. Again, we got here at 6 a.m. And we are standing back to allow the Coast Guard and search and rescue to continue their search and rescue operations while we gather information from the command post. There is a lot of information that we can begin to collect. We have a team of 24 on scene, including Member Brown and me. The team of experts include experts in nautical operations, and what they're going to look at and begin to collect is information on vessel operations, safety history, safety record. They'll look at the owner, they'll look at the operator, and they'll look at the operations this day. Today, they will also look at company policy, any sort of safety management system or safety management program will be looked at by them and our human performance team as well. We have a human performance expert here. We have an engineering team. We have survival factors, and then we have a team here that is getting the recorders. We also have a highway safety team, our team out of the Office of Highway Safety, including structural engineers, bridge experts who will be here and are continuing to come in. We have a few here, and one or two others are coming in the next few hours. We also have our family assistance team on site, and our family assistance team works with those that were affected by a particular event, families, friends, and other loved ones, and they will help them get in touch with the resources they need while also providing them with the information that they need as we move forward with our investigation. This is a team effort. There are a lot of entities right now in the command post, all focused on search and rescue, as they should be. But I do want to, in particular, thank the Coast Guard, the Maryland Transportation Authority Police, the Federal Bureau of Investigations, the Baltimore Fire and Rescue, and the Maryland State Police. I also know that there are others on scene I'm sure I have missed. For example, Army Corps of Engineers is here, a great deal of expertise, and all focused on what is very important, which is the people first. I have been in contact with my counterpart in Singapore. Director Chong is the director of transport, the Transport Safety Investigations Board. The NTSB The NTSB maintains relationships with our counterparts in other countries often and stay in close communication. So the director and I have been in communication many times before on safety. So it was a good conversation. He is sending some personnel here tomorrow. Also, personnel will be arriving from the Maritime and Port Authority of Singapore, who has the focus of being the regulator in Singapore. Now, it's not a lot of information that I can share at this time, and I know there's a lot of information that seems to be circulating. The NTSB doesn't speculate. We provide facts.
There you go. That is Jennifer Harmandi from the National Transportation Safety Board talking about that terrible bridge collapse after that Singapore-registered ship ran into it in the waters off Baltimore, and the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapsed. There is that footage. It's unbelievable, isn't it, to see it just collapse like that. She said a search and rescue mission is still underway. The Coast Guard and the search and rescue teams still trying to find those six people that we understand are still missing. The NTSB will look at the safety record of the ship, the owners of the ship, the management of that ship. They will gather the recorders. They also have bridge experts on the scene. We'll bring you more as we get it. Back now at Sunrise. In breaking news, authorities are searching for six people who were on a bridge in Baltimore that collapsed after a ship hit it.
This is a live look at the mangled mess right now. A Mayday alarm from the ship allowed people on the ground to stop cars from travelling over the bridge, which has avoided even more deaths. For more, we are joined by Associate Professor Colin Caprani from the Head of Structural Engineering at Monash University. Thanks for joining us. Well, these pictures, so confronting, unbelievable, really. Seeing the bridge crumble before our very eyes, we know there was that Mayday call, but how do you think something like this unfolded?
It's absolutely tragic, and of course it's something as a profession we strive every day to make sure it doesn't happen. It's devastating to see it. Clearly the ship was off course. It was out of the main navigation channel and it struck a critical support on the bridge. This kind of support has no redundancy, we call it, which is a way of carrying load in an alternative way. So once the support was removed, the bridge really had no way of staying up.
So it sounds like there are reports there was smoke coming out of it beforehand. Maybe it lost power. I guess people want to know, could this happen, you know, in Australia?
Yeah, and of course, I guess people might remember in 1975, we did have a ship impact on the Tasman Bridge in Hobart. Can it happen? Look, it's extremely rare. We don't have in Australia so many bridges in main navigation channels. We also have extensive protection measurements against this kind of thing happening now. The Australian standard for bridge design has very rigorous rules against it happening. I think what's happened here is we have an older bridge that did have some protection measures, but these protection measures did not keep up with evolving vessel traffic in the harbour. And so I think we should try to learn from this and say, look, if the vessels around our structures are changing, maybe we need to continue to improve and update the protection measures around our structures.
Well, President Biden has already offered to pay federally for a replacement bridge, so that is some good news. Very much appreciate your time. Thank you. Welcome back to Sunrise. The Governor of Maryland has just spoken about that Baltimore bridge collapse. Let's take a listen.
This is very much still a search and rescue mission. We are still actively looking for survivors. We know, and that's the pledge we've made to these families, and this is still very much an active search and rescue mission. And there is not a single resource that we will hold off on deploying. I have already authorized the deployment of everything from air, land, and sea resources to make sure that this search and rescue operation is carried out to its fullest intent.
Breaking news, one body has just been recovered following a cargo ship collision into a key bridge in Baltimore in the US, sending it crumbling into the water. Eight people, all construction workers, were on that bridge at the time of the crash. Two were saved, while five remain unaccounted for.
This is a tragedy that you can never imagine, right? And I was awake when Chief Wallace called me, but never would you think that you would see, physically see, the Key Bridge tumble down like that. It looked like something out of an action movie.
The ship was able to issue a mayday call just moments before impact, which allowed officials to stop traffic and save lives. For more, we're joined by engineering professor Tim Wilkinson from Sydney University and Jeff Osborne, an Aussie living in Baltimore, to get a range of insights into this breaking news. Good morning to you. Tim, we know there was a mayday call before the collision. How do you think this went so wrong?
Oh, good morning, Natalie. Bridges like this, they are very long and they require a lot of balance between two long spans. And it seems that what happened was that the ship has knocked over the pier support that's holding up this bridge and made it unbalanced. And tragically, this is what has resulted.
So we understand there are more than 8,000 ship movements each year under this bridge. Obviously, ships are used to going under there. How could it have gone so wrong, do you think?
Well, media reports have been suggesting that the ship did lose power, and that's probably why it wasn't going directly under the middle span of the waterway and ended up hitting that pier.
So there was a requirement for a harbour master to be on board, and we understand there was one. I guess they couldn't do anything.
Look, I'm not up with exactly what might have been happening on the control levels of that particular ship, but I think that's a very likely scenario of what could have happened, Natalie.
This makes people worried, I guess, when they see something like this that, you know, doesn't look possible and think, could it happen here?
Well, there was a collapse of a bridge in Tasmania about 50 years ago, but I think people can have confidence that there's a lot of risk mitigation in place. I mean, only in the last few months, one of the large ships that was meant to go up the Derwent River was denied permission to do so because there were concerns that it was so large and that the wind might actually blow it into a pier. So one of those Antarctic ships that the Australia's recently built is actually not allowed to go underneath the new Tasman Bridge in the Derwent River.
Do we have more stipulations here, for instance, in Sydney, and have more tugboats around the ships?
Well, I mean, in a place like Sydney, we're actually quite fortunate that the main bridge across our harbour does not have piers that are in a harbour, and that obviously that keeps it much safer. But we do have requirements about having either a pilot directing the ship or tugboats that make sure that they do keep in the proper shipping lanes. Mm.
Jeff, let's go to you. You're living in Baltimore. What's been the reaction to this horrible thing happening?
Yeah, look, I think a lot of people here are obviously pretty shocked. I mean, and a lot of people are talking about it in town. I've probably had a bigger reaction from friends and family back home have been checking in on me. But, yeah, it obviously happened at 1:30 in the morning here, so I didn't really find out about it until I woke up in the morning. And, yeah, it's obviously dominating the news cycle here in Baltimore.
It's the critical link, I understand, between Washington, D.C. and New York City, and more than 30,000 cars a day use it. How much of an impact is this going to have on Baltimore?
Yeah, look, Baltimore and D.C. are really close together. They're almost one city, kind of like the Gold Coast and Brisbane is, and there's 10 million people in that area. So that road does take a lot of traffic, and Baltimore has it's part of a ring road that goes around the whole of the city. And so now with one side of that cut off, there are two other tunnels that run under the harbour nearby, but even on a normal day, those roads get incredibly busy and the traffic, you know, stands still almost every afternoon and most mornings. So I can't imagine the traffic is going to be anything other than really bad now for quite some time.
Jeff, looking at these pictures, what was your reaction?
I mean, yeah, I drove across the bridge not that long ago and, you know, my first thought was how scary it would have been to been there. And, you know, it sounds like the guys did a good job of alerting cars and stopping cars from going across, which is quite incredible when you think about it. But, you know, the time of the morning obviously contributed to that. If that had happened during peak hour, the number would have been enormous of the people that would have wound up in the river there. And it was, you know, it was like 2 degrees Celsius last night, so it wouldn't have been a good time for a swim.
Yeah, exactly. And they're still treating it as a search and rescue mission. Still five people missing in those waters below. We thank you both for your time. This is a live look right now at what is left of the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Daylight has revealed the full extent of this tragedy. It happened at 1:30 a.m. local time. Eight construction workers fell 56 metres into that river below. One person has died, two were rescued, five are still missing. A Mayday call gave workers some time to stop traffic, about 90 seconds, we believe, just moments before that ship crashed. That quick response saved lives. President Biden has spoken about the collapse and promised to rebuild the bridge. Leaving port under the cover of darkness, this is the moment disaster struck. Within seconds of the collision, the bridge collapses at breathtaking speed, plunging into the water.
The entire Key Bridge in the harbour.
Shock as authorities register what's occurred.
We can see one, two, three remaining sections of the bridge. From there on out, from land, the bridge has collapsed.
Road workers and their vehicles sent tumbling into the river below. In a slowed version of the footage, you can see the lights of the ship go out and black smoke emerge as the vessel lost power. As dawn broke, the sheer scale of destruction became clear. Where the centre of the bridge once stood, tangled metal juts out of the water. The cargo ship that caused the carnage stranded in the middle of the river. Part of the wreckage still strewn across its deck. The massive search and rescue operation continues with helicopters and divers sweeping the river. Live to US correspondent Miley Hogan, who's right there at the scene this morning. Miley, it's unlikely those missing will be found alive now.
And they are certainly facing some very extreme conditions, but authorities here are holding out hope. They've said that they've promised the families that they would do that and that they will continue this search and recover or rescue those people that are still missing. I'll show you what we can see from where we are. It is incredible to be standing on this roadway and looking up at where that bridge would have been. You can see that the road goes up and then it disappears, and where that structure would have been, that Key Bridge. Now, those people, those construction workers that were on that bridge, the fall would have been 56 metres into the water, and it is very frigid conditions. It's around 8 degrees in the water, and they have now been missing for around 15 hours.
Really, you've got 30 to 60 minutes before you hit exhaustion, and then usually death after 3 hours. So this has been going on for close to 12 hours now, and it's a recovery operation.
Local authorities have recovered one body from the water. They are still looking for five others, hoping that they have been able to survive. As the day goes on, we are learning more details about how this occurred. We know that a Mayday call was made from that ship, which did give authorities time to block off traffic getting onto that bridge, which authorities say saved some lives.
Okay, thank you, Miley.